She just missed her mouth and spoon of food there. How could she do that? Anyway, we're in Psalms 122, so let's go ahead and have prayer, okay? Father God, we thank the Lord for the day. These are not trying times. These are exciting times, simply because we know you're in control of all things. And Lord, we just know you're giving us different methods and means in which we can share our faith. And so, God, we just ask that as we progress with these things, that, Father, you'll give us open opportunity to share. Lord, we thank you for our Bible study on Wednesday night, for the time that we're able to get together. And, Lord, it just makes us realize how important those times are now when we're not able to do that. So we just want to thank you. We just ask you to speak to us through your word tonight, Lord. In thy name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Special prayer request. Do we have any for it?
Aaron's still having to travel.
Hey, Aaron?
Everywhere.
All right. Okay. Others? Nobody has prayer requests?
Our nation and our county.
Our country. Okay. Our country.
Okay. Okay. Remember our seniors, too. We have a lot of seniors that are homebound and are confused. Remember my parents? They don't know they're in the world right now. Don't know what's going on. And so remember those. Sandy, remember her parents in prayer. Continue to remember Justina's family in prayer.
Healthcare workers,
especially those healthcare workers, those that's jobs.
Our hospital has started accepting masks made by the community for the nurses that are not in direct care of patients. So, like my area, they're recommending us wear the same mask for a week, and then if people make cloth masks in the community, they're recommending us wear those to conserve PPE across the hospital.
Okay. Do you have a pattern to those masks?
Yes, I have it in my email. They've sent out a pattern today.
If you would send that out, I know a lot of ladies that are home that would do some sewing. We actually have about two massive totes of material that somebody brought in here yesterday. So if somebody's interested in doing those, get with Justina. And I don't really know how hard. I think it's just basically folding in it and sewing.
Yeah, it seemed pretty... Okay, I'm not a sewer, but it...
Go ahead. You aren't going to hurt anybody's feelings.
But no, it didn't look too difficult. But...
Seems simple to me, preacher.
My mom can do it. She just got laid off from Lazy Boy.
Oh, okay.
Okay. Anyone else? We're all good. Anybody have anything great you want to share? Jeff Moore, give us something good.
It's a SAR.
I'm having a
great,
tremendous barbecue sandwich right now.
I cooked.
Yay.
All right. He's eating well.
That's right.
Anybody else? Anything good?
Well, the fact that we can see each other, have Bible study.
There you go.
My first time on Zoom.
Mine too.
You look so thin, too. It's scary. Enjoy this.
Carla looks like she's
I just told you I want to lose 30 pounds automatically.
See?
Okay, anybody else? All right, let's get started. And then we'll go to prayer in just a minute. We're in 120. We're kind of continuing on with where we left off. And I said this is kind of hard simply because we haven't been in Bible study for several months now, or weeks rather. We're out last week because of this virus, and the week before that was a business meeting, and it seemed like there was something the week before that. And so it's kind of hard just to pick up and keep rolling. We've been, for I guess, assuming that anybody else is going to watch this later on, we've been in the Psalms for about a little over a year now. And so we're in Psalms 122. And I do want to thank Mark and Deanna for setting all of this stuff up, for getting us connected for Wednesday nights. And Brother Albert did Sunday school lesson earlier, so that's going to be available online or via Facebook as well on there. So you might want to be looking at that also coming up. And then, like I said, I'm new at this. You know, I'm not techie at all. And so we just want to thank them for that, for going this extra mile and getting all this stuff done here. I was telling Mark earlier, Wade sent me a text that I'm kind of familiar with, Texas, the other day, and said, well, can you copy and paste this? And I thought, well, I'm not going to tell you what I thought, but I couldn't copy and paste it. So that's my level of expertise in all of this thing. But anyway, we're thankful for there, and we're just thankful. It's kind of a nice thing. I can see all of you. I don't know who you can see, but it sure is a good thing to see your faces and to know that you're doing okay. I want to remind you, you've got 10 calls to make before the week is out. Remember that? You need 10 calls on your phone, not text or emails. 10 people that's out of your comfort zone in church that you just need to call and say, hey, trying to get my 10 calls in. How you doing? What's going on? Life good? Life bad? Can I pray for you? Find out those things. So you need your 10 calls in before Sunday. We're also looking at doing not just via Facebook Sunday morning service, but to do an outside drive-up church as well. I know for sure that if we're still not able to congregate by Easter, that we will be doing a drive-up service for Easter. I know that for a fact, and hopefully, probably Sunday as well. We'll get that out on information for you to find out about on that. Okay, let's go ahead and get started then. Psalms 122 is a song of the degrees of David. David is writing this, and this is so ironic how that God always works and speaks to us. But this whole psalm, David is addressing the joy that it is to be able to go to the temple. It's a psalm of excitement, how that these folks who are traveling to the temple are just ecstatic about being able to go there. Matthew Henry said, how lovely is the sanctuary in the eyes of those who are truly sanctified. How lovely is the sanctuary in the eyes of those who are truly sanctified. Meaning that a lot of people who come to church really don't understand the joy of it. It may be a social event. It may just be a gathering. But we know that when we come into God's house, our whole purpose is to worship the Lord. And that's where our joy is at. That's where we find great joy in worshiping the Lord here. And so this is one of those psalms that increases in that. Now, if you remember when we did Psalms 120, the singers are in a foreign land, and they're just beginning their journey to the holy city. So Psalms 120 is about the journey, beginning the process to the holy city, which would almost be like if you're going to Disney World or Disneyland or one of the Disneys, and you're making that preparation, and your kids are excited, and you're counting hotel costs and everything that goes in with that trip. That's what Psalms 120 was. They were just beginning their journey to the holy city. Then when we studied Psalms 121, 121 appeared to have gotten inside of the city. They've begun the journey, and then Psalms 121, they're able to view the very thing that their hearts desire. They're looking out, and as they're a great deal away from or a great distance away from, they're getting excited because they can see where they're going to. So then we get to 122, and 122 we're at tonight is simply now have touched ground. The plane has landed, their feet are on the gates of the temple, and everything that they had hoped for, everything that they had dreamed for, is about to fall into place. Now, again, the best way I can relate it is a vacation-type situation that we understand. You know, you make all of that preparation, and then you're about that journey, and whether it's to the beach or wherever, if Carla and Jeff are tonight there from the beach, and the journey to get there. But it's not exciting until you take your shoes off and you step out into the sand and you realize it's everything that you'd imagine. So this is what Psalms 122 is about. They have reached their destination. They are where they want to be. And they have made their way to God's house, and they are in God's house. But listen, I have never in my life longed to be in a house full of Jesus people as I do right now. I miss not being in church. I miss not seeing your face. I miss the fellowship. I miss the noise of it. I miss the love of all of it. You never really understand how much you love people till you're not around those people. And then you just long. To me, like I said earlier, it is a great joy for me just to look and to see your faces. And I don't know what you all are seeing, but it should be a great joy for you to see this face. Just kidding. But I miss church. And I spent the other night, Sunday night, she and I were sitting at home, and I said, you know, I can't imagine people who just intently miss church and don't come to church, and it doesn't affect their heart. I'm telling you this, you cannot tell me you love the Lord and you say I don't love his church. You can't have one without the other. You can't have the bride without the groom. The bride and the groom equal one. And so I just am more than I ever have felt before, that I'm telling you this, you just, something's not right if you're not missing church right now. If not that fellowship, but not just the fellowship, I miss the worship. I miss us not worshiping together. I miss those haze, and I miss just those songs, and I miss just that peace that comes when we gather together. And so did y'all see the meme on Facebook for the big fat guy? I don't know who he is, but he's running down the aisle and he's going crazy. He's jumping, he's hopping, and he's coming into church for the first time. And somebody sent that to me and said, this be you, and I said, oh, you have got it. I'm telling you, we're probably going to eat the first Sunday we go back. I'm thinking a Baptist dinner. That's got to be something there. But I just am excited about us getting back together and just worshiping the Lord. And that's going to be me. I'm going to tell you that. I just can't wait till all of this mess is past and life gets back to a little bit of normal again. So in your prayer, pray and ask God, God, we have taken for granted the normal, and we would sure like to have the normal one more time. And so I can't wait to be in the company of like-minded worshipers. Our hungry souls are only satisfied by the Scripture of God. I think that everything that we long for and some of the emptiness that we are feeling right now as we're secluded and we're isolated is that we long for the Word of God. I think that when we do it by ourselves and we do our own Bible study, it's great. But that's the thing I love about Wednesday night, and that's why I was excited about us getting together as we are right now, because this allows you to have input as well. So you know, like on a Wednesday night, if you want to jump in here at any point, you have the right to do that. But I think it's a treasured privilege to be able to be with God's people and gather in God's house and hear God's word. David knew this. As David is penning this psalm, he is inspired by the worship that was taking place. It wasn't drudgery to him, but it was delight to be a child of God, and it was never a burden, but it was always a blessing for him. So imagine worship just being that blessing to her heart. Now, can I get a hey? Have you missed the worship?
Hey.
There you go.
Hey!
We just the worship. Amen. Or hey, we just miss that worship. Sometimes, and I guess maybe this is one of the things that I filtered in, is that to me, sometimes church can become a little mundane. We can allow it to become the same old, and we can be in the same old rut or the same old process of doing things. And if God has done nothing else in this whole mess, he has caused the church to arise. And I think that that's what we need to do. This sleeping giant, it's time for us to rise. And so in this passage of scripture here, David is talking about what a privilege it is to be able to be in the presence of worship and of God's people. You see, corporate worship serves as a preview of what heaven is going to be like. If you can't enjoy corporate worship right now, heaven might be a little boring for you. If you can't enjoy being in a fellowship with those who are forgiven and those who know the Lord, then heaven might not be what you think that heaven is. But corporate worship is when one or two or three or four are gathered in my name, and God promises what?
He's there in the midst.
He said, I will be right there. I will be in the very midst of it if two or three are gathered in my name. And so ironically enough, I mean, we have four that are here and, I don't know, 14, 15 that are out there. And so we are gathered in the very midst of God right now to worship him. And so this redeemed, these that are born again, we are actually getting a little bit of the foretaste of what heaven's going to be like. Now, just for a minute, before we got started, and we were just all kind of goofing off and aggravating. Did it not make your heart smile? Mm-hmm. Did it not make you feel good? Oh, there's my family. There's my friends. There's my home. There's that corporate worship that I have longed for and that I have missed out. You see, it's with great joy that all the saints of God assemble together in God's house. Now, this is what David is saying. This is what Psalms 122 is about. They were about a journey to the Father's house. They were able to see the Father's house. And in this psalm, they're able to enter into the Father's house, and guess who they met when they went through the door? They met the Father. He said, where two or three are gathered in my name, I'm going to be in the very midst also. And so he has met them there. This gathering is the very joy that the psalmist is trying to express here in Psalms 122 as he arrives in Jerusalem, the holy city. As he enters into God's house, he is trying to write down just exactly how his heart feels. Now remember, this psalm actually was written earlier than the temple. It was actually written during the time of the tabernacle and was incorporated later on. And it's a song of entrance. The people would sing this song. I was trying to think earlier, what are some songs that, Mike, what are some songs that you all used to sing when you were going on vacation? 99 bottles of beer in the wall. I don't know. Did that go through yet? Yeah, it'll catch it.
Backstreet Boys.
The Backstreet
Creek,
Boys.
Okay. Back Creek Boys?
Oh, the Backstreet Boys.
You know, okay. That boy band, good Lord.
Oh, one of those boy bands, Megan, I forgot. Yes. But you know how you just kind of sing the song along, and so this is what they're doing here. They are singing this song as they in a sense, head to where they need to be. Now, as I said, Psalms 122 is the third of the Song of Ascent. Psalms 120 to Psalms 134 is a progression of songs that capture the progress of worshipers as they're traveling to the city of God for one of the religious festivals. And so there are these psalms that are traveling psalms that are written that as they go, it makes a lightness of heart, but it also teaches their children a lesson as well. Now, I'm going to chase a rabbit for 2 minutes. If you're home and you've got your kids there, there has never been on earth a better time than to start learning some basic Bible stuff at home. Books of the Bible. I would love for our kids to come back and say, I've learned all the books of the Bible. I've learned a Bible verse every week. Noah, can you learn a Bible verse this week? No, David, can you learn a Bible verse?
Yes.
No? Sure you can. I know you can. I just think this is a great time for parents to be able to have this one-on-one and to institute some things that are so important here. And so they are on their way to one of the religious festivals, and David is recalling all his joy of going up to Jerusalem to worship God. Now, it is not about the trip. Don't get me wrong. He talks about this trip, but it's not about the journey. It is about getting to the temple and worshiping God. It's not about from the house to here. It's about getting here and walking in and with great joy expecting God to do what? Speak to us. To reveal himself. What's the sense in studying God's word if we're not excited about God revealing himself to us through this word? Now, later on, and strategically, this psalm, this altar is placed later on. I said that already. These believers, as they would travel, would in a sense canonize these songs. So they would write them down, and they would teach them to their children as they travel. Now, this lesson was that they would never forget what God has said or what God has done in their lives. Now, I told you earlier, you have to remember this is important because Psalms 120 was about that preparation and the journey. And Psalms 121 was being able to see what was out there. But Psalms 122 tonight is the important one because they have reached the destination, the very thing that they had longed for, they had reached. Now, in this psalm, it's easy to understand it, and there is a comparison between the psalmist as he traveled to Jerusalem compared to us as we travel to glory. We understand that when we accept Christ, we begin that journey. And for some, the journey is long. For some, the journey is short-lived. But for us, as we travel that journey, we get excited the more that we're able to see what's out there. Now, every day, someone asks me, Pastor, is this the end of time? Are the days numbered? And the Bible simply says, no man knows that time. I can't tell you. I can tell you that so many things are being fulfilled right now that it would take a blind man and a deaf man not to be able to see. There are so many things. I had someone today that showed me this thing they learned, and they add all these numbers up, subtracted a few, and put in the coronavirus in there, and the next thing you know, it added up to 666. And they were just, oh my gosh, is this taking place right now? I'm just telling you this. You need to be ready, because no man knows the hour nor the day. Could the Lord come within the next 2 minutes? He sure could. Could he come this week? He sure could. Could he come next year? He sure could. You know, I just think that preparation is what's important. And so in this journey, in this procession to Jerusalem, David shows us this extreme gladness. The psalmist has finally arrived to his destination. And I think that if the Lord tarries his coming, or if the Lord comes again, my heart really can't get any more happy than it is right now. I am seeing, and I say this every time that we meet, I'm excited about what's going on. I mean, I don't want to see the loss of life, and I hate to see people put in hard positions, but there has never been a time any greater than right now for us to share our faith. People are longing and desiring to know what truth is, and who better to share that truth than God's church. And so we said, well, you know, we're pretty much homebound. How do I do that? Listen, if it has to be, you've got your emails, you got your texts, you got your FaceTime, you have 1,000 doors of opportunity to reach a far greater people than you do in a one-on-one. And so I encourage you this. I told you earlier, I encourage you, you need to call 10 people on your list, people that you are not heavily acquainted with, somebody out of your comfort zone. Don't text them. Don't email them. Get on your old phone. Dial the number. Get the phone book out. Dial the number up and just find out what's going on. Now, don't get in your comfort zone. This is also a great time for the church to call the lost, to call the people who would not expect you to ever call them at all, to find out how they're doing. You know, people are, I always used to share this. Whenever we had a grocery store, once I went into ministry, and I would talk to somebody about the Lord, it was almost like, well, I just expect that. You know, he's a preacher. I expect him to tell me about Jesus. But they never expected me, the grocery man, to tell them about the Lord. And so in your daily walk every day, people are expecting maybe the deacon, maybe the Sunday school teacher, and especially the preacher or the youth minister or someone like that to share their faith. But it just blows their socks off when you are willing to simply say, man, in the midst of all of this, I have this peace because I have Jesus in my heart. I have this peace that passes all understanding, and it's because I'm a child of God. And it opens up a great door of opportunity. There are 1,000 ways to share your faith. When somebody talks about being fearful, what does the Bible say about fear? He says, fear not. We're not given that spirit of fear. He says to fear not. When people worry about tomorrow, he says, why, the lilies of the valley and the birds of the air, they don't worry. He promises us our daily bread. He said, my seed shall never beg bread. He doesn't say they won't beg steak. He says they won't beg bread. I will make sure that your needs are met if you trust me. And so I'm telling you this, I encourage you. We have a great opportunity right now to share our faith in so, so, so many ways. Now, again, I want to get back into this. In verse 1, it says simply this, and I want to read the whole thing. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Our feet shall stand within the gates of Jerusalem. Jerusalem is built as a city that is compact together. Whether the tribes go up, the tribes of the Lord, unto the testimony of Israel, to give thanks unto the name of the Lord. For there are set thrones of judgment, the thrones of the house of David. Pray for peace in Jerusalem. They pray for peace of Jerusalem. They shall prosper that love thee. Peace be within thy walls and prosperity within thy palace. For my brethren and companions' sakes, I will now say, peace be within thee. Because of the house of the Lord our God, I will seek thy good. Now in verse 1, he is entering with extreme, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. This word glad doesn't just mean that I was just skipping along and I'm just happy to be here. It was with great excitement. And as I said earlier, the only way I can compare this to is little kids going to Disneyland for the very first time. And they walk through, you know, that gate and they see that palace and Mickey and Minnie come up and the reality of what they have wanted for so long is right there. That's the kind of gladness that David is talking about here. He says, I am rejoicing, I am full of laughter, I am full of delight. He says, those who spoke to him, he says, let us go to the house of the Lord. He's not just talking about himself here, but he's talking about all of those who are around him, all of those who are about a journey. Now listen, we are all about a journey here. We're on a journey to the Father's house. You know, my favorite passage of scripture in all of the world is where it says, see that you fall not out along the way. You're on your way to the Father's house, Joseph told his brothers. And we are all about a way to the Father's house. We're all about a journey. Now, different roads and different paths and different lives and different ages, and everything is different. But the bottom line is that we are about this journey. So he says in verse 1, and he compasses everybody who loves God. He says, then be joyful because God has opened this door to us. Let us go into the house of the Lord. Now, not to the house of the Lord, but let us go into the house of the Lord. Let us get where we're going, and don't stop us at the door. But let us get in that we might worship God as God would have us to worship him. He says, our feet shall stand within the gates of Jerusalem. Again, I reiterate what he's saying here. We're not about the journey anymore. We're not seeing the temple far off, but our feet are now at the door. And so, begs to answer the question, is the Lord existing to time? I don't know, but I believe with all of my heart my feet's at the door. I believe that even in my lifetime, at my age, that I am closer to heaven than I've ever been before. And so I take great joy in knowing that my feet are out the door. Then he says in 3, Jerusalem is builded as a city that is compact together. Now, that's a real interesting verse because he basically is saying here in this verse, he says this compact together. Jerusalem is causing folks to come close together. I don't know if you were like me, but when we were kids growing up, there were times that all of our family would get together. My aunts and uncles would come and my cousins would come and we would all be in one house. And my mother used to just make a pallet in the middle of the floor. Anybody know what a pallet is?
Yes.
There you go. Just a bunch of blankets, quilts on the floor. And every kid would get on that pallet, and we would pile on that thing, and we would go to sleep. And it was the most fun in life. And so we would compact on that pallet together. Now, that would be an uncomfortable thing to do if those were strangers and people that you did not know. But when it was your family, when it was those that you loved, it was the greatest overnight you ever spent all of the world. And this is what he's saying here in this passage here when he says there, oh, Jerusalem is built as a city that is compact together. He is saying that in the temple, we are compacted people of like mind and of like goals and of like love. He says, we are packed in there just as close as we can be. And we are so stinking happy because it's with our brothers and our sisters. It is a wonderful thing to do. Now, they also make this public declaration of the name of the Lord here. He says, his people, his people. He goes on in 4 and he says, whether the tribes go up, the tribes of the Lord, under the testimony of Israel, to give thanks unto the name of the Lord, for there are set thrones of judgment, the thrones of the house of David. Now, in this passage here, when he begins to talk about it, he says, Jerusalem, let me explain this as best I can. When we think of Jerusalem, and we think of the temple, we mainly think of that in a religious realm there. But Jerusalem was not just the center of the church or the temple, but it was also the center of justice and of equality as well. And it represented the reinforcement of what is right. So when a person was to go to Jerusalem to seek whatever answer, whether it was a religious question or a legal question, they knew that this place where the throne of judgment stood. And we like to think of that as being only in the realm of the religious, but it was also a place of the law at all, where the right was rewarded and the wrong was punished. It was a place where the innocent was defended and the guilty were prosecuted. This was what Jerusalem was called. It was called the House of David. Now, it was called that because it was the royal city of Israel where David had set. He was enthroned there, he presided over his people there, and he dispensed judgment from there. Not just religious judgment, but he dispensed legal judgment as well. Now, you say, why is that important? Well, it wasn't just a place where people came to worship, but it was also a place where in worship we find truth. You know, in the realm of God, that's the only place that we can find truth. But in Jerusalem, they also found there that legal decisions were made as well. And they believed that if you would get truth in the religious realm, that it was the city that you would also get truth in the legal realm as well. I always say this, right is always right, and wrong is always wrong. Amen? Right is always right, and wrong is always wrong. And so here, folks believe that in Jerusalem, that right would always be proved and wrong would always be disciplined in whatever realm that you were in, or for whatever reason that you went there, that this seat of government was in place and that the king of Israel presided over that. And if David, who presided over that, was a righteous judge in the realm of God, that he would also be a righteous judge in the realm of the world as well. And so he says here, whether the tribes go up, the tribes of the Lord, unto the testimony of Israel, to give thanks unto the name of the Lord, for there are set thrones of judgment, the thrones of the house of David. So that joy of going to Israel was to know that when you went, for whatever reason, you'd find truth. Now hold on and listen, that you would find truth. Had it ought not be that when a person enters into the doors of our church, that they find truth. Everything that I proclaim from the pulpit, had it ought not be truth. You see, now here's where we begin to water things down, because we have a lot of people who have taken the Bible and they have allowed it to melt, so to speak, and to fit into molds to fit different genres and different sins. And rather than saying, thus saith the Lord, right is right and wrong is wrong, we have taken the word of God and we have kind of appeased the people who listen to it. I remember years ago, and I've probably shared this before, and not that I'm a super fan, but I remember one time hearing Al Moyers, who was, I assume, is probably still the president of Southern Seminary. But he was on one of these talk shows with David King, and they had a priest, a rabbi. He represented the evangelicals, and I forget what other religions were there. But I remember him asking each of these other men how a person got to heaven. And they gave their opinion of how a person would, in the end, know God. And I remember he said something so profound that I never forgot it. This has been probably 20 years ago. He simply said, all I can tell you is what the Word of God says. I don't have an opinion in the matter. All I can tell you is what thus saith the Word of God. And if I tell you that, that's truth right there. And I believe that with all my heart. I just kind of believe, though, that the church today has allowed themselves to become so watered down that rather than offend people, rather than to speak truth, these individuals were ecstatic that they were going to the temple, because they knew that when they went into the temple, they'd find truth. They knew that they would not be deceived. They knew that they would find truth in that thing. And I believe that's the most important thing in all of the world. Now, he goes on and he talks about this peace of Jerusalem in verses 6. He says, pray for the peace of Jerusalem, that they shall prosper that love thee. Peace be within thy wall and prosperity within. For my brethren and companions' sake, I will now say, peace be within thee. Now, this is kind of a really interesting thing here, because this peace he's talking about involves international peace with the surrounding countries and those that would have business with Jerusalem. But he also talks about this internal peace that comes through Jesus Christ. He says that within the church, there should be no division. There should be no disharmony. There should be no friction. And he urges the church, he says, because the temple is a place where you find love and you find harmony. Now, of all of the things that I would want people as they drive by our church day in and day out, is that they would go by and they would say, man, that's a church that loves each other. And I think our greatest attribute as a church is that we are people who love one another. We love each other. And I think that is the most blessed testimony that our church has. And here, David writes it in his song. He says that when they set their foot into the temple, there they found peace, and there they found love, and there they found protection from the hostile nation. And he says this verse, he says there, pray for the peace of Jerusalem, that they shall prosper that love thee. Peace within thy walls and prosperity within thy palaces. For my brethren and companions' sake, I will now say, peace be within thee. So he's saying here, he's saying, listen, he says, this peace that we find comes through Jesus Christ. Now, who is the author of confusion?
The devil.
He's saying, this is this comparison of other nations. He says, pray for peace with other nations, that these other nations come in and they bring confusion. But you see, we battle not against flesh and blood, the Bible says in the New Testament, but we battle against principalities. We battle against Lucifer, Satan, the old liar, the devil himself. And he will do everything that he can to cause disharmony within the church. But here he says, no, he says, peace be within thy walls and prosperity within thy palace. For my brethren and companions' sake, I will now say, peace be within thee. And I think that's the sweetest thing in the world, because the writer is saying to me personally, and he's saying to you, my prayer is that you have peace in these trying times, in these crazy, confusing times that none of us have ever seen before. We should have such a peace in the midst of all of the confusion to know that God meets our needs. Amen? He goes on and he says, verse 9, David leads the charge. He says, because of the house of the Lord, our God, I will seek thy good. David says, I'm going to be the first one through the door. My foot is going to hit the door first. I'm going to be in the presence of God. I'm going to confess my sins. I'm going to go to him. I'm going to let him speak to me. I'm going to change my ways. I'm going to serve him. I am going to rejoice in this worship. David leads the charge. And so in your life, it's you who have to kind of step out. You know, dads, you are the spiritual head of your house. You lead them. Moms, you have a tremendous responsibility keeping everything going. You know, young people, listen to me. Oh, choose him while you're young. Kids, accept Jesus Christ right now. But you may lead the charge. You be the David. Because of the house of the Lord, our God, I will seek good. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Amen.
Amen.
Y'all happy?
Yes.
All minds clear.
Yes.
Can I get a hey?
Hey.
Let's pray. Father God, we sure thank you for this night. We thank you for your precious word. And Father, I know that I have rattled on. But Father, the simple message is that we are about a journey to your house. And Father, the road is long and weary at times, and it uphill sometimes. But Father, we're right now being able to get a glimpse of what glory will be like and what that new Jerusalem, that beautiful land, will be like. Father, there are some that will step in there first, who will beat us there, unless you just rapture your church and take us on home. But God, I would in my life want to be able to stand and say, I'm willing to take that step. I choose Jesus. I want to be in his presence. I want to enjoy that worship and that fellowship. And I want that peace that passes all understanding to know that I'm a child of God. And so, Father, I pray for those who will listen to this, who will hear to the very end, that, Father, that they too, their lives might be changed and drawn closer to you. Father, until we meet again, we ask your will be done. In thy name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
I've enjoyed being with you tonight.
Thank you.
Thank you, everybody. Good to see everybody.
Love you. Love you.